I recently switched jobs, but I keep this discussion as I'm still a web, sorry, an app tester, so mobile app tester, but I now recently moved to a web environment.
Okay.
And also in different language. I'm now programming in C Sharp in a Microsoft environment.
Okay. So okay. You have this the Slack link?
No, I don't have it.
I'm gonna send it to you, okay?
Yeah, it's good.
You need it after the Q&A. Okay.
Yeah.
So I'm going to post the link right now, and in 5 minutes we start, okay?
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the third session of Testmasters Academy Online Conference. I'm going to introduce our speaker right after I say a little thing about the Testmasters. Conference is organized by Testmasters Academy and Global Quality Leadership Institute, which I founded. My name is Anna Roizman. And the idea is that we bring test masters from around the globe to the people around the globe without any interruptions with the, sometimes you cannot go to conferences in different states or in different countries or in different places of the globe. I was fortunate to go there, so this is how I meet a lot of those people that I'm bringing to you in Testmasters Online. Our next conference is in New York. It's Contest NYC. I created a special code for people who attend my online conference. It's Testmasters 25. It gives 25% of the tickets. I hope you join us as well, because all the offline conferences are fun. It's a different experience, but as of today, we have Simon Peter Schreiber for how to pair test or pair program with the developers, how to work together with developers. And here we go.
Okay, thank you very much, Anna. It's a pleasure to be with you online, and I hope you will get some good information of my experiences. So who am I? I'm Simon Peter Shriver. Simon's first name in a passport, but people call me also Peter. 53, coming from the Netherlands. I'm married with Jacqueline, and I have three kids. I'm an independent tester since 2005. And I'm founding member of the Dutch Exploratory Workshop of Testing, a group of freaks from the Netherlands, conferring all the time. And next week, by the way, we have our 8th peer conference, so it's still going on. And my current assignment, software design and engineering test at the bank at the moment. But I'm a tester, and I'm constantly challenged to extend my skills, not only doing testing, but doing something more. I'm challenged to support my team, which is based on Scrum, and I'm also challenged to learn to do some programming. But I hate to say, but the industry is sort of demanding this, that the tester must code. But yeah, if a tester must code, it's a bit of a issue, because you will get an average programmer, but you will lose an excellent tester if you don't look out, because the testing skills are different than the programming skills. But that's not all. You see already here, which program language do I need to learn? They say start programming. I say which language? But I have some answers on that, because of course this crossed my mind. And you're working together. You're working together with the software development team. And in that life cycle, some test work needs to be done, but also some development work needs to be done. And some of this work has a common interest in, because programming needs to be done. And if you need to learn a programming language, why don't you start learning the programming language your developers are working with? Because you can help them to write code, but they also can help you to write some tests, some automation. So a developer helps a tester and vice versa. But be aware, what are you doing then at the moment? Are you pair programming or are you pair testing? To give some more context to the two phrases, pair testing, when a tester asks a developer to look into a problem which you accounted in the code, you are going to check it out together to see if it's a real problem. In that situation, you talk about pair testing. You are testing an error, and the outcoming the outcome of this this session is information. Is it a bug or not? This means that you as a tester are in control. So therefore we say it is pair testing. When a developer asks a tester to look into a feature to see how it works, and you can end up in a session where you write some code or you rewrite some code or perhaps even create some new code. In that situation, you talk about pair programming because the outcome of this session is code. Either it's changed or it is new. The developer is in this situation in control. Therefore, you talk about pair programming. So a lot of stuff can be done from a functional point of view. And now you see an overview. At the bottom, you see the developer. And at the top, you see the tester on the left-hand side. And on the right-hand side, you see a lot of test phases, which are, as I see them, and that can be a bit different from other people's view, but therefore I'm going to go in a bit more detail to explain what I mean by this and how I work with it. So we start with unit tests. That's a small testable part within the application done by the developers, not that difficult to execute. And it gives some information to the developer, early feedback, the earliest as possible. But this is done in an isolated environment and you check whether it's working correct or not. But as you know, this is only a single thing, but more of those units need to work together. So one unit can depend or is depending on another unit. So you have to combine those units to create a new test. Therefore, you raise here we connect more two or more units together. It's called, in my perception, an integrated unit. It's a relation between units which you need to test. But there is a small side effect because when a test fails on the unit integration level, which of the component is giving you failure? So you need some troubleshooting for this. But if you have a lot of those integrated units, you can end up in a UI, user interface. And for this test, you don't have any interactions with the other screens or peripheral systems. It's only the UI itself, all the integrated units within the UI, you try to see if they are working. And but you then try to see if they provide an output to a user interface, to another user interface, or to a peripheral system, but you're not connected with it. You only check if the output is there. But as I say, with the unit, you also have UIs which you can combine. So you have also UI integration test. You have some UIs connected to each other. You check out the relations between the two. And the thing is, you stay within the app. You don't go to an external interface. So we don't talk about an end-to-end. You go to the next situation. There you have a flow of UIs or either a complete end-to-end of some processes. It is an interaction with virtual peripherals. I say virtual because you are always in control. You never have problems with backends which are not stable or whatever, but that needs some maintenance. And that virtualization is created by some mocks. You have also the situation where you really want to have the interaction with the real systems. You can say these are the so-called regression tests where you have the real end-to-end flow and availability of the backend system, the real systems are needed. But the advantage of the previous test phase or test situation where you test with the virtual environment, you can use it as a reference to see how the real environment is working. Now you go to regression tests, which are not automated. These are just things you do which we call so-called manually or not supported by automation, because it is not in place. You do that with developed software, new interfaces, or a really complex situation which is difficult to automate. And then you fall back on not automated, not automation supported test. It can also be platforms which are difficult to operate, or other mobile apps if you stay within the mobile context. When you say regress, you improve is in place, and if you have done your regression test, you can add some new stuff to your automation, or you maintain it, or you delete some of those tests which are not longer needed. Now, exploratory test, yeah, that's the test we are doing ourselves. The test is executing it. It's not supported by any automation. It's based on new or change functionality with the focus on where can I find the problems. And it always has a risk-based approach, because you're looking, as I said before, you're looking for problems. Where can I find them? The exploratory test has output. You create a new or change test on the main path, the alternative path, or the error path. These tests can be added. Also, these tests can be used for automation. You can either change some tests which exist for automation, or you create new ones. So a lot of stuff passed by on different moments of the software development life cycles and the different kinds of testing. But as you see in this situation, there are a lot of opportunities. But the upper layers are giving feedback to the lower layers. And the lower layers provide the information to the upper layer. So it's always an exchange of information. From a responsibility point of view, the unit and the UI are most of the time under the lead of the developer, where you as a tester can support. The end-to-end test, whether it's virtual or real, the test can be or is in the lead. The developer for sure will support. Yeah, and if you do a regression test or exploratory test, you're on your own sort of, and therefore it's also your responsibility. But what about automation? Where do you automate now? For sure, the first five test phases, automation can be done for sure. Hence, a lot of automation needs to be done there, which support your test goal. And the end-to-end test with the real environment, that can be semi-automated. If you have some difficulties with environments, or you have cross-functionality between apps, that can be something which is difficult. There you have semi-automated environment. Yeah, and the exploratory test, as I said, that's something you do by yourself, not to support it in the sense of automation. And the dependencies, yeah, with the first five, you don't have any dependencies at all, because everything can be developed on your local machine. And if you have the build running locally, everything is on your local machine, everything is in your local device. So you can do a lot of testing without any problems of having no peripheral connection. As you see here, a timeline, because unit test starts in the beginning and then you gradually go to the next level. But in my perception, when I wrote this down, there's a mistake, because exploratory tests you do all the time. Even on unit tests, you can see, hey, what kind of things can I do for my unit? What kind of input can I give my unit to see what the output is presenting? So exploratory tests, it's always, all the time, during the whole, as you see it now in this picture, during the application lifecycle. So a lot of work during the life cycle, and you can do a lot of things together. As you see here, we continuously test during the application life cycle, but we also develop a lot of things also during the complete application life cycle. But as a tester, I have a constraint in my role because I'm a mobile app tester. I have an extra challenge. As I'm the only tester in my team, I have to learn two programming languages. That is Swift for the Apple devices and Java or Kotlin for the Android devices. So I already can show you some things I've done. You see here on this screen where you have some switches to flip and some data to put in. Here's a small example of a unit test in Swift. And this is a UI test of the same screen, where you then flip the switches, put some input in it, and then see if it is validated as means of that the button is enabled or not. And here you have a flow of a lot of screens, but with that screen I mentioned before in the journey, and there you can do some serious testing to see if everything is working or not. This is then an unit test example for Java. You can see it's a bit different. That's sometimes for me hard to switch languages, but believe me, if you're into it, it will gradually become more accustomed to you that you're programming in two languages. Here I have an example of a UI test, and here I have an example of an end-to-end test. That's also a flow. What you can see in the end-to-end test is that I have I can say same approach. I make it readable and so to focus on writing. And that I always see that things are more or less the same. Here you have another example of an end-to-end test. So with virtualization, which is important, you mock backend, do some responses, and the great big advantage is that you always have access. You can use it in early development if the backend is not there, but the documentation of the JSONs, the interface, the API is defined. You can create the mock and use it later on also as a reference, but you can start working with your app and test the interactions to that mock. And here are some examples which we then created. It's based on the WireMock tool, where you set up some connections and get references to JSON files, and then you can then interact between your app and the mock environment. As with automation, as a team of developers and testers, we test together. We also develop together to have the automation in place, because we know and we find it very important. Together we decide what we need to automate, of course, if possible. And we consider this as a part of our development process. And we also see that the automation code is also development code. And as we're working together, we share the same tools, we share the same repository. My code of testing the automated tests are a part of the development repository. By having some coding experience, I can help with their work, they help with my work. The communication is very easy, because he is in the problems. So there's the developer come always with their skill how to solve a problem, but we as a tester always are on investigation to find out where things can go wrong. Therefore, our mission is different, but we share the same vision to build software which we can deploy at any moment in time, check by which help us to make those decisions to stakeholders. Some information about pair testing you can find here. Also on Sticky Minds, you probably will find some of my articles. These are some mug shots or action photos. On the left-hand side, you will see me with my Android developer. On the right-hand side, you see me with my iOS developer. Great guys. I really appreciate the effort they put in me learning their language. My journey so far is that discussion whether you should automate end-to-end scenarios is always there because it is a shift left as we now see as a popular phrase, but I say it's more of moving to the beginning of the development life cycle, so expand instead of shifting, because you still need to test on the end-to-end level or in the regression level. We write scripts and to support our testing, to support the unit test, UI test, end-to-end test. Learn to program in Swift and in Java, Kotlin, which will follow soon. And I help where needed to fill up with the features. And I have the privilege of developing a small feature in Swift code for the app. With the support of unit test and UI test, we will have mocks in place to help us testing with the functionality of the app when the backend is not available, or to support it as a reference. We try to come up with end-to-end tests to support the regression needs. And we always try to see if we can hook up our stuff to the real environment. So a user story approach is, we start with the defining of the test cases to see whether we can do a unit test or a UI test. See if we have some information about the APIs, the JSON files, if we can do some automation. I need to say that we base our framework on Nespresso. Probably you recognize some of these in the examples I gave of the code. And we do a lot of fine tuning on the UI level, on unit level, the exploratory test. We look for the edge cases. And always investigate is needed to see if any regressions are occurring. So there's a lot of stuff during a use story where we put a lot of effort in and unit test automation, UI test automation, and end-to-end automation. So the conclusion I can say that. As a tester, make a conscious choice of which coding language you're going to learn. Make sure that your choice adds value to your team. And if you want to have maximum support, learn the language of the programmers they are working with. because in that situation you can work together as a pair, whether you do testing or programming, in the context of automation. So this is what I wanted to say to you. So I say thank you, and yeah, probably we will switch over to Slack.